I would like to firstly declare that I am a parent of a child with Down syndrome. My son, Aiden, is therefore by common definition a child with special needs. The first few months of Aiden's life was probably the most challenging period in my life. Down syndrome children typically have certain associated medical conditions. So at the beginning, I was at KKH almost every other week for a slew of medical appointments. Other parents whose children have special needs would probably share similar experiences. In addition to the worry about the children's health, there is also always that nagging fear about their future, how society would see them, whether they will be able to take care of themselves when they grow up, what will become of them when we, the parents, pass away. It is not uncommon to hear this, and I believe the Honourable Member, Ms. Denise Pua, would have shared this, that these parents often say that they would rather live to see their child die so that they could ensure that the child's needs are met to the end. It is heartbreaking to hear. This worry is not unjustified. A quick sensing of the current environment suggests that society, whilst now more open and accepting of people with special needs, is still not completely comfortable with them. The National Council of Social Service, NCSS, conducted an attitude study with 1,400 citizens and permanent residents in 2015 and found that the public viewed persons with disabilities less favourably than those without a disability. They also had less favourable attitudes towards those with intellectual disabilities and autism spectrum disorder. The Lian Foundation's Inclusive Attitudes Study, conducted in 2016, echoed this finding. Half of the parents they polled indicated that they were uncomfortable about their child having to sit next to one with special needs in class. I also hear stories from parents of children with special needs about how people treat their children. One father shared that on one occasion, a few young children were running towards his daughter. They probably just wanted to play, but their caregiver was heard shouting, "不要去那边, 她是神经病的人." "Don't go there, she's a crazy person." Several months back, I heard on the radio a caller commenting on a discussion on inclusivity. The man said that his wife is a teacher and that there is a child with special needs in her class. His wife must have shared her challenges with him. He said that he was of the view that these children should not be put in the same class as normal children. They were disruptive and caused a lot of problems to the teachers and the class. He felt that parents of children with special needs are in denial and they want to believe that children are normal, so they insist that their children be in mainstream schools when they actually should be taught elsewhere. Honestly, I understood where this gentleman was coming from. The challenges faced by teachers in such settings are real. We need to deal with these challenges. I will touch on this a little later in my speech. But the caller's solution to the problem offended and hurt me as a parent. His tone and curt manner in which he declared his views reflected how he felt about children who are different. They should be taught separately, kept apart from normal children. I appreciate it may not be completely fair to postulate from his brief remarks what he thought of people of special needs in general. To me, though, it felt like a rejection that children like Aiden will always be seen as a burden, that they should be put in appropriate places. I cried my eyes out that afternoon. So what does all this have to do with the motion today? Why am I telling you these stories? There are many different aspects of the motion that we can debate about today, but I would like to speak about inclusive education from the perspective of persons with special needs. The reality is, while Singapore has made great strides in encouraging and promoting inclusiveness within our community, we have some way to go in truly walking the talk. Our society is still not yet able to truly view persons with disabilities as an equally valid member of the community. And I believe that we can review and build our education system so as to change perceptions, normalize disabilities, so that people can appreciate that persons with special needs are simply differently abled and are of no lesser value than any other member of society. Singapore has done a lot towards building an inclusive society. The government started the journey in 2007 when the first Enabling Master Plan, EM1, was drafted and adopted. EM1 outlined a vision where persons with disabilities are fully integrated, empowered to reach their potential, and are contributing members of society. A decade later, the third Enabling Master Plan had been drafted and is currently being implemented. However, there are still gaps and areas which we can give more attention to so as to truly embrace people with different abilities and give them the opportunity and motivation to excel. I would like to say at this juncture that this is not about seeking special treatment. A pragmatist may also say that it would be unreasonable to expect the government to put in large resources and funding to address needs of only a small percentage of people in the community. But I trust one can agree that enhancing inclusiveness within our education system will bring great benefit to Singapore as a whole. Firstly, fully embracing people with special needs within our community creates opportunities for people to be more caring and compassionate. I recall a conversation I had with you, Mr. Speaker, when you were then the Minister for Social and Family Development. You feel strongly that people with special needs have a role to play in helping build kindness and empathy in the community. They are conduits through which we can elevate the level of compassion among Singaporeans. I fully agree. Research shows that a genuinely inclusive education system allows children to build and develop friendships that they might not have encountered otherwise, as inclusive settings encourage higher levels of interaction than segregated settings. What results is better outcomes for social and communication development and an early inculcation of values of inclusion. Such early exposure benefit both children with and without special needs, where they will be better able to demonstrate greater compassion, empathy, and have better understanding on how to interact with their peers and accept diversity. These children could develop better interpersonal skills and exhibit greater adaptability. These results could already be seen at Kindergarten, a preschool by AWA, Singapore's first inclusive preschool. At Kindergarten, children with special needs and different backgrounds study together. Learning is personalised and children are taught to embrace diversity and respect for each other. I accept that the model is not necessarily easy to replicate, but for now let's focus on the results that could be achieved if we truly set out to be inclusive. Secondly, there is great future economic value in equipping our special needs children with the necessary skills so that they could be independent. Research shows that when children with special needs are being supported to communicate with their peers, they enhance their independent communication, mastery of augmentative and alternative communication strategies, and have increased speech and language development. If we intervene early in schools, we give them the necessary skills and prepare them for the future, there is a greater chance that they would graduate school and join the workforce. If they can work well, be independent, and contribute meaningfully towards the economy, less resources need to be spent on support structures or schemes when they are adults. In light of the above, I make the following recommendations to enhance the education landscape. For one, we should have an integrated education system and school setting. A common misunderstanding of an inclusive education is where there's simply a presence of students with disabilities in a classroom or school setting, but where micro or macro exclusion still occurs. If there is segregation and children are not treated equally within the same setting, that is not truly inclusive education. In 2012, the Ministry of Education announced that 20 special education SPED schools will be paired with mainstream schools so that students from both schools have the opportunities to mingle, for example, during recess and at school events. I understand that there are also lessons in character and citizenship education in mainstream schools that help raise awareness of disabilities and how each person can play a part in developing an inclusive society. Schools have also forged partnerships with VWOs to provide opportunities for students to interact meaningfully and deepen mutual understanding. These are all great efforts, but we need to build on them. So we should have an education system where children with and without special needs learn and play within the same setting, but in different pathways. I believe that this is more accurately described as an integrated education system. That way, students can receive different support and assistance based on their needs, but yet have the opportunity to interact meaningfully. Currently, there are special needs students in mainstream schools. However, such arrangements in some situations have been challenging for the teachers as well as the students, those with and without special needs. We hear many instances where the teachers and the allied educators cannot manage the students and the class situation. Teachers get stressed, the students in class are affected, parents chime in and express their unhappiness about the arrangement, and everyone is discouraged by the efforts to be inclusive. So to do this properly, we need to build the proper support structure and have sufficient resources. One key resource is the group of teachers who are trained to teach students with special needs. It appears that there is currently a shortage of such teachers. While there is a growing pool of allied educators specialising in learning and behavioural support, and a large number of teachers trained to meet special needs in mainstream schools, teachers have been reported to be short-handed in managing students requiring additional learning support. In addition, we have also seen reports in the papers about the Lian Foundation survey, which alluded to a high burnout rate of professionals working with special needs children. 51% of the 423 professionals surveyed felt that burning out quickly was one of the key challenges they faced. 44% said salaries and benefits were unattractive, while 34% pointed to manpower shortage as a challenge. We therefore, secondly, need to improve the profession and career pathway of special education teachers. Currently, these teachers are hired by various social service organisations who are guided by the salary scale recommended by NCSS. The general perception is that these teachers receive less recognition and their pay packages are less attractive than their counterparts in mainstream education. I propose that these teachers come under the purview of the Ministry of Education, like their peers in mainstream schools, so that they could have access to the same salary scales as well as career opportunities, which would in turn raise the stature and attractiveness of the role and encourage more to pursue a career in this profession. Having more educators trained in supporting special needs would better support the learning needs of our children and ensure that they can achieve their fullest potential. These teachers can then be tapped on to support students in the mainstream or SPED schools. In the same vein of building resources, I would make a third recommendation that we also build synergy between the education and health sectors so as to ensure that access to the necessary assessments is enhanced. Early identification of learning difficulties can help ensure that students who have such needs receive the necessary support as soon as possible. However, parents often cite long waiting lists for MOE psychologists when seeking to have their children assessed. Taking a leave from the GP partnership program in the mental health sector, I propose an MOE psychologist partnership program where several recognized private psychologists can provide assessments for learning difficulties. To address high costs, the identified practitioners could provide subsidies to families with CHAS cards, with part of the costs subsidized by the government. Lastly, I propose a review of the administration of school curriculum for both mainstream and SPED schools. Our children are all unique, with different talents and abilities. Often in the school system, we are pushing them into categories or groups, which allows for a more expedient delivery of information and knowledge. However, this means that we may not be fully developing their strengths and addressing their weaknesses. For example, at the moment, children with special needs in mainstream schools are still expected to complete the same curriculum as their peers. Support is given when their natural abilities fall short of what is required, but if we are really serious in allowing each child to flourish, there may be value in adjusting a curriculum according to each individual's needs, pace of learning, as well as providing the facilities and resources required to cater to the wide spectrum of disabilities. Mr. Speaker, I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak today. I thank the members who have proposed the motion. I am supportive of the motion, however, I am of the view that it would be useful to give some resolution to the matter at hand. Therefore, Mr. Speaker, with your permission, may I propose an amendment to the motion?
Can I have a copy of the amendment? The amendment is in order. Are copies available for members?
Yes, I have given copies to the clerks for distribution.
Okay, please move your amendment.
Mr. Speaker, I beg to move in line 4, after the word learners, to add the following words. By building an education system that A, gives each student the best possible support and the opportunity and motivation to excel. B, recognizes ability and talent in every student and offers development paths suited to their unique strengths and interests. C, enables Singaporeans to improve our lives, paying special attention to students from vulnerable families. And D, becomes a platform to bring our young together to build an inclusive and united Singapore. Mr. Speaker, allow me to conclude. Paulo Coelho said that a child can teach an adult three things: to be happy for no reason, to always be curious, and to fight tirelessly for something. My son teaches that to me every day. I'm glad we are debating this motion, and I hope our children remain our most important source of inspiration. Developing a good education system that is inclusive and suited to the times should be a constant work in progress. I believe our robust discussion today will contribute towards the continued development of a quality education for all children in Singapore. Thank you.